want to welcome you to this morning's briefing on behalf of the common good. Thank you all for joining us. Before we hear from Professor Roubini, I want to tell you a little bit about the common good. Many of you may not be familiar with its mission and its activities. As we can see, there's a great sense of frustration in America today. Americans are worried about the economy, their educational system, our role in the world, and whether our government can effectively function. That frustration can be seen in the growth of the Tea Party, as well as the expanding demonstrations on Wall Street and around the world. The Common Good is a nonpartisan organization that strives to inspire broad participation through the free exchange of ideas and a civil dialogue. We encourage each person to be informed and aware and do what they can to make a difference. What I find most satisfying is that this organization puts you in the room with opinion makers and leaders who are shaping this country and the world for the sole purpose of fostering a decent, honest, and thoughtful dialogue. Without being partisan, this is the antithesis of the Republican debate we saw last night. Previous guests have been President Bill Clinton, Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, Governor Bill Richardson, Senators Mark Warner and Chuck Hagel, Mayors Bloomberg and Cory Booker, Arianna Huffington, Paul Begalia, and Ed Rollins. The upcoming events include Catherine Cryer on November 1st, Senator Claire McCaskill on November 14th, a discussion on the 2012 election on November 17th with Ken Mielman, Bob Schrum, and Richard Wolff, and a briefing by Ambassador Peter Galbraith on November 29th on the Afghanistan war 10 years later. All of this is exciting stuff, but your help is needed. These programs are only possible with your support, and I hope you will join. Let me introduce Charles Meyers. Charles has a distinguished career in financial services and is now a senior manager and director and head of institutional equities at Evercore Partners. A graduate of Amherst College and Cambridge University, he has worked in London and Mexico City, as well as New York, and truly appreciates the challenges in our global economy. Charles.
Great, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I have the honor of introducing Dr. Roubini, and before I do that, though, I also just want to acknowledge Patricia Duff, who has done so much incredible work out there. We've worked on a lot of things together, and I think that the intelligence and the passion that she brings to both the common good and to getting people from, you know, again, all across the political spectrum in one room to actually have a dialogue is truly admirable, particularly in today's political climate. So, Patricia, thank you for everything you do. Honor of introducing Dr. Roubini. Dr. Roubini's had a very long and distinguished career both in academia but also in public policy and in public service. He's the founder and chairman of Roubini Global Economics, an independent global macroeconomic research firm. He's also currently a professor at NYU's Stern School of Business, and before that was a professor at Yale. From 1998 to 2000, he was senior economic advisor for international affairs on the White House Council of Economic Advisors, and after that actually was an advisor to Tim Geithner at the U.S. Treasury. He worked on, amongst others, he worked on the Asian financial crisis in the late 1990s as well. He's published 70 policy papers on international macroeconomic issues, co-authored several books, including last year, Crisis Economics, A Crash Course in the Future of Finance. Very cheerful stuff. He's widely cited in the media, both in print and on TV, as an expert on global macroeconomics. And I think most notably predicted, starting in 2005, the housing market collapse and the global financial crisis that ensued in 2008. His nickname is Dr. Doom. For those of us that work on Wall Street, whenever he's on CNBC, we immediately turn the volume up, listen to what he has to say, and then we get very depressed. But he does have an uncanny habit of being correct. This breakfast is very timely and very topical, given what's happening in Europe. And I know that Dr. Roubini has, I think as early as yesterday, called for a double-dip recession, both in the U.S. and in Europe, and he's also calling for a Europe-wide TARP, which is very interesting given how unpopular it was actually here in this country. We'll see if 17 sovereign countries in Europe can get their act together and implement something like that. So again, Dr. Roubini, thank you for being here. This is a wonderful time. Over to you.
Good morning,
everyone.
Do you hear me?
Is the mic on?
Yeah, you still have to use that.
I still have to use this? Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming this morning. Thanks to Richard Duffin and Common Ground for inviting me again. I was here. And to Sherman and Sterling for hosting this event as well. I'll try to give you a bit of an overview of how I see the U.S. and the global economy, and then I think we'll have a bit of time for Q&A and discussion and so on. If I had to summarize my views, as was pointed out, I think there is a significant chance we're going to have a double dip recession in the United States, in the Eurozone, in UK, and most advanced economies, and I'll try to explain why in a few minutes. Now, whether you call it a double dip recession or a continuation of the first recession or a second recession, I think it's a bit semantic. The question is whether we're going to have weak economic activity and a contraction in most advanced economies, and I think there is more than a 50% probability that that's going to be the case for reasons I'll explain. The case of emerging markets is different. Emerging market economies are still growing strongly. They have better balance sheets in the private and public sector, more room for policy response. Their potential growth is much higher than advanced economies, so I don't expect a recession globally, but certainly if there is going to be an economic downturn in advanced economies through trade channels, financial confidence, stock market, commodity currencies, there will be an economic slowdown also in emerging markets. And how much of that slowdown is going to depend on those trade and financial links and the extent of the severity of the economic contraction in advanced economies. And already in financial market, there's been a significant correction of equity prices, currencies, and fixed income, even in emerging markets, as they're seeing this weakness in US, Europe, Japan, and so on. Let me try now to explain you why I think that an economic contraction is more likely. And you have to always to make scenarios. It's a question of probabilities, of course, not black and white. But I think why the case is that there's going to be an economic contraction. And you know, a few months ago when I was saying this, was not as much of a consensus. Now even a lot of the sell side research says there is maybe 40% plus probability of a recession in the US and in Europe. The first observation I'll make is the following one. After the economic and financial crisis of 2007-2009, the economic recovery in most advanced economies, including the US, was what I refer to as a U-shaped recovery, anemic, subpar, below trend, as opposed to the typical V-shaped recovery that you get after any plain vanilla recession. You know, in a normal recession, output falls, but then there is 2 or 3 years of high economic growth because there's a lot of slack in goods and labor markets. So you can grow in the US, say, 5-6% for a couple of years until you go back to potential growth that is closer to 3%. In this kind of economic recovery instead, we've not had that V-shaped recovery. Growth has been consistently below trend for the last 2 years. Say last year, growth in US was around 2.6%, that is below a trend growth of 3%. And that's one of the reasons why the unemployment rate has remained stubbornly high. In a typical V-shaped recovery, the unemployment rate shrinks very fast as you get a job creation when you start economic recovery. And now, I've been saying for a while that the recovery will be anemic, subpar, below trend, because this was not a typical recession, but a recession caused by a financial crisis, and a financial crisis caused by excessive amounts of debt and leverage, both in the private sector initially, households, banks, financial institutions, even a fat tail of the corporate sector, and as a result of the crisis, we've had also a massive increase in also public debt.